of the Italian authorities. Police tactics and ticketing arrangements were both criticised. England's chances of staging the event in 2006 don't appear to have been affected. Peter Staunton, ITN Sport.
On News at 10 with Trevor McDonald tonight, more on the new individual savings accounts, how they could benefit your finances. Plus, raging out of control, the desperate battle against the hundreds of bushfires.
It's not the same. You know, you look back at photos and you realise how quickly they grow up and how quickly things change, and then you think about all the stuff that you never got around to doing and you wish you had.
You know, those early days when the kids were young, they were the best of our lives. But things change. You've got to learn to enjoy what you have now.
I know.
Yeah, the kids haven't disappeared, they've just grown up. You've got to enjoy that and not live in the past.
You're right, I know you're right. Just take me a little while to get used to the idea, that's all.
You take all the time you want.
Where do you want these?
Anywhere, wherever you can find a space, I'll sort it out later.
Sure?
Yeah, of course I'm sure.
Well, okay, then thanks for everything, the big adventure. Well, come on, it wasn't a complete disaster.
Yeah, no, some things were really good, like around the campfire and everything. Yeah, that's true. That's
probably where it all started.
Thank you.
Well, the stories we told, I'm probably spooked, Eddie.
Yeah, I shouldn't have done that. I know how much she hates snakes.
Yeah, you can say that again.
You know, I think that it was those spooky stories that made you dream up a snake.
Well, I told you it was a nightmare.
No, well, I'm not so sure.
Well, whatever it was, it was a good idea to come back early. The right decision, all things considered.
Yeah. Well, it won't happen again.
Well, that's all right.
Next time, we will check out the van completely before we get settled, and there'll be no spooky stories.
Next time?
Yeah.
Look, no, Mum, I think once is enough.
Yeah, I thought you were only joking in the car.
You can't possibly mean that.
Of course I do. You have to persevere with camping. This was just a tryout. Next time, it'll be great. You'll see.
There you go.
Oh, thank you, Willie. That's very thoughtful.
Okay. Anything missing out there?
No, not as far as I can see. I shut the gate, though. That's probably how Holly got out.
Yes.
Nothing's touched in here except for the painting. Well, it's lucky we came over, isn't it?
Indeed.
Well, she's nowhere to be found. I looked right around the block.
We're back!
Oh, here come the cavalry. Too late.
Too late? Too late for what?
Well, we think Mrs. D's had a break-in.
Helen, you OK?
Yes, I'm fine. Why are you home so early?
Oh, a bit of a camping disaster. I'll tell you about it later.
Yeah, what happened?
Toady and Billy saved the day. There's no point in ringing anyone, Philip. The boys have looked around. It wasn't a real thief, it was just some kid.
Helen, it doesn't matter who it was. If they've done it once, they can do it again when Bill and Toady aren't around. I'll call the police.
All right, party's over. Come on, clean up time. Chop, chop.
What, now?
Yeah, now.
Do we have to?
Now. Start with those two. Put them in your room. And don't just dump them anywhere. I want all your things put away properly. Dirty things in the laundry, clean things in your drawers. And put them away carefully. Don't just push them in any old how. Pants with pants, socks with socks.
Yes, Captain. Understand?
And I want your T-shirts folded neatly and laid out.
Oh, well, righto.
OK, we know. This
okay. Taught you so well. Right. Hey, who's having first shower?
Me first.
I don't need one.
Will Smith struts his stuff as the Fresh Prince over on BBC Two in a moment, followed in 20 minutes by more teenage angst in Heartbreak High.
You can find the perfect blend. That's when good neighbors become good friends.
This week in 999 Lifesavers, a prized possession becomes a floating inferno.
One of the cylinders exploded. came past me like a rocket and just brushed my hair as it went past.
A vintage aircraft suffers a bizarre twist of fate.
There was a bang and the propeller just disappeared.
The propeller's gone! The propeller's gone!
Plus safety tips for you and your pets.
It makes you realise how precious life is.
999 Lifesavers, Friday at 8 on BBC One.
Half an hour on BBC Newsroom South-East. Has John Prescott started a spending war with some of London's richest councils?
Peace for the woman who fought through the courts for a dignified death.
And checking your ID in the blink of an eye.
More at 6:30.
The 6 o'clock news on BBC One with Martin Lewis and Moira Stewart.
Save as you shop. A new savings scheme will be on offer at supermarket checkouts. It's meant to attract low-income savers, but it'll mean more tax for the better off. Council tax bills are to rise by up to 10% to pay for better services. A blow to England's prospects for the World Cup. The team is not being seeded. And going soon from a cinema near you. Local adverts have got the chop. Good evening. A new tax-free savings scheme encouraging you to save while you pay your bill at the supermarket checkout is being planned by the government. They hope it will appeal to many people on lower incomes. People with the existing TESA and PEP tax-free schemes will have to transfer money across to the new individual savings accounts, ISAs for short. But there'll be a top limit of £50,000, and the government admits that hundreds of thousands of what it calls very well-off people with higher saving levels will end up paying more tax.
I can get these details quickly to you.
Tax-free savings have become big business. Virgin Direct is one of many companies selling personal equity plans. Together they have sold PEPs and TESAs to 7 million people, who get £1.5 billion of tax back from the government. But it's the well-off who have been benefiting the most.
It is to the government's disappointment and our own disappointment that the people who really take advantage of PEPs today are the wealthy. That's going to change.
The new individual savings account is specifically aimed at encouraging people on low incomes to put money aside. There'll be no minimum on the amount you can save, and you can get at your money any time. It doesn't have to be locked away for years. Anyone will be allowed to invest up to £5,000 a year in it, although there'll be a lifetime limit of £50,000, a worry for some. Hundreds of thousands of people who have saved over the limit will end up paying more tax. That'll hit people who have put money aside for their retirement and those using PEPs to pay off their mortgages.
I'm disappointed. I've made allowance for the tax breaks that were within a PEP to actually repay my mortgage after 25 years. And with those tax breaks now disappearing, I think I'm going to have to, certainly going to be sitting down and rethinking my plans.
The scheme was launched by a government minister who is himself at the centre of a tax avoidance row. He brushed aside concerns that under the new scheme, the better off would lose out.
They're already very well off, I think, by most people's judgment, and I think that the people that we're aiming to target here, and I think generally the commentators, when they see what the purpose of the scheme is, namely to take that money, to spread it as widely as we can, and fairly. Don't forget, fairness is at the heart of Labour's tax policies.
The government is hoping to make ISA savings easy by involving the supermarkets. The plan is that as you charge your baked beans to your plastic card, you can slip some money into your savings account.
The mechanisms are there. We have 12 million customers going through our tills every week. There is already the ability to take money out of the till and also to put money in through our instant savings account. So we should be able to do it reasonably well, and we welcome this initiative from the government.
But despite these inducements, not everyone is convinced that the ISA scheme will actually achieve its aims.
Fundamentally, the government is trying to tempt people who do not save now, who perhaps keep the cash in their back pocket, into savings. And that's going to require quite a change of mind. And I do wonder if the incentive is great enough to really tempt people to start changing the habit of a lifetime.
In trying to encourage even those on modest incomes to save, the Chancellor Gordon Brown has announced plans that would increase the tax on the rich. That's something that until now he's been keen to avoid. Anthony Brown, BBC News.
Council tax bills in England could rise by an average of 7% next year, and some by as much as 10%. It follows the government's announcement of how much money it's planning to give local authorities for spending on services. The Deputy Prime Minister, John Prescott, also told MPs there'd be a slight relaxation of capping levels. He said it amounted to what he called a truce in the war waged by the previous government against local authorities.
Councils had warned that much of the extra money for schools would have to go on other services unless the government relaxed capping limits, allowing them to raise more from council tax. Today, that's just what John Prescott did. Delivering Labour's first council settlement in 18 years, he loosened the ratchet and said that councils would have no excuse to divert schools' money.
It can and should be spent in the classroom, reversing the years of neglect. This means the pressures identified by the local government association and enables a start to be made on raising educational standards, which we're all determined to see.
But the opposition smelt something else, the scent of a big Labour tax rise.
The net result of what he has announced today will mean that council tax bills could rise by as much as 10% next year. Does he realise that for many elderly people, this wipes out at a stroke any advantage that they might have had from the winter payment scheme?
So what sort of bills can householders expect next year? Since 1994, average bills have risen steadily as the government increased the amount raised locally. Spending plans allow for an average 7% rise next year, taking the average bill for a bandee home to over £700. Individual rises will vary widely, but experts believe the final average will be more than government figures suggest.
Perhaps 8.5% or even a bit above that, but probably not into double figures. I think the government will have made sure it doesn't happen like that. And some authorities have money in their reserves they can take out to hold the figure down, but certainly higher than in recent years. And of course, if it were 8.5%, three times the rate of inflation.
For Oxfordshire, which was capped earlier this year and faces a financial crisis, the settlement brought little relief.
There is a hope of some good news for schools in that some of the cuts we've had to make in the last few years may be restored through the reallocation of money within our budget, but that is only going to be at the expense of really quite significant cuts to social services, libraries, roads and so on.
Despite the talk of much higher bills, the proof of the pudding will come next spring when council tax bills start to go out again. John Andrew, BBC News.
Formula One motor racing has lost its permanent exemption from the proposed ban on tobacco advertising and sponsorship. Details emerged while the Health Minister Tessa Jowell was being quizzed by a Commons committee today. There will now be a time limit on the exemption, although the exact duration has yet to be agreed. Our chief political correspondent John Sargent reports.
A European ban on tobacco sponsorship may hit Formula One after all. The government were backing a permanent exemption, allowing tobacco companies to go on advertising on these cars for as long as they wanted. But now a compromise looks likely. With negotiations due on Thursday in Brussels, the Health Minister, Tessa Jowell, has told a Commons committee that the government will consider a proposal which would only exempt Formula One for a limited period.
We're not there yet, but we believe that this is a good basis for further negotiation.
She argued that the compromise had been suggested because of Britain's strong negotiating stance, but opposition MPs insisted it was yet another U-turn.
There has been no change in government policy.
The Tories complained that the government were still treating Formula One better than other sports. Their representatives had been given a special meeting with Tony Blair.
These people got a meeting with the Prime Minister, which was denied to other sports for whom tobacco sponsorship is, if anything, more important than it is to Formula One. And if anybody is seriously trying to pretend that one of the reasons they got that meeting was not that they had given £1 million to the Labour Party, then they are really asking us to believe something that is totally incredible.
And an announcement today demonstrated how keen the tobacco companies still are on motorsport. British American Tobacco have become the first of them actually to own a Formula One team, Tyrrell.
We're in it for the long term. We're not just expecting instant success, but we're in it for the long term. And a lot of the money is being redirected from other sponsorships which we're discontinuing, like the motorcycling and powerboat racing.
It seems that the government were forced to abandon their insistence that Formula One should be permanently exempted because that couldn't be agreed with the other member states. But that's left ministers open to the charge that they're backing down because of the widespread hostility to their original plan. John Sargent, BBC News, Westminster.
Britain is setting up an international fund to help Holocaust victims reclaim gold stolen from them by the Nazis. The Foreign Secretary, Robin Cook, says Britain will contribute £1 million. He made the announcement at the opening of the London conference on Nazi gold.
They came from Albania and Argentina, the Ukraine and Uruguay. 240 delegates gathered to shed light on one of the murkiest episodes in history. The Foreign Secretary, Robin Cook, in his keynote speech, confirmed that Britain had launched a new international fund to benefit survivors.
As the country that has taken the lead in setting up the fund, it is right that Britain should start the fund going. I'm therefore pleased to announce that Britain will be contributing £1 million to the start-up of the fund.
Under sustained criticism, the Swiss banks have paid out more than £100 million in compensation to Jewish survivors. And Switzerland is fiercely resisting pressure from the World Jewish Congress to pay even more.
We lack all understanding for this demand. Switzerland has not participated in the Holocaust. And nevertheless, we have established unprecedented measures to come to terms with all questions around this issue.
But the presence here of those who've suffered, such as slave labourers, is keeping up the moral impetus.
We worked in a factory where we slept by the machines. We worked tremendously long hours on starvation ration. If people were too weak, they were shot, new ones were brought in. I think this has to be recognized as a fact. We must be rewarded, we must be paid and apologized to.
What happened to the gold and valuables plundered from the Nazis' victims is one of the key questions for this conference. One historian said here that it would take 10 years to unravel all the remaining secrets of the Nazi gold. By that time, most of the dwindling band of Holocaust survivors will be dead. John Silverman, BBC News, at Lancaster House.
The Russian President Boris Yeltsin has offered to further reduce the country's nuclear warheads by a third. He made the offer during a press conference at the start of a three-day visit to Stockholm. But Russia has yet to ratify the last arms agreement with America, which would make much deeper cuts in its arsenal than President Yeltsin has now proposed.
England's chances of winning next year's World Cup in France have been dealt a blow by football's ruling body, FIFA. It's ruled they won't be among the tournament's eight seeded teams, so England now have to face a top-ranked team like Brazil or Germany in their opening group. The England coach, Glenn Hoddle, said he was disappointed at the news.
The stage is being set for the greatest football drama on earth. Even for the prelude, all eyes will be on the Stade Velodrome in Marseille this week, where the names of 32 nations will go into plastic pots for the draw. France, the hosts, and Brazil, the champions, are seeded automatically, but neither England nor Scotland are judged to be among the six other star performers.
We have Germany, Italy, Spain, Argentina, Romania, and the Netherlands, which have been designated seeded teams.
England will be based at the hotel near Nantes, where they stayed for Le Tournoi this summer. Victory there confirmed their current good form, but failure to make it to the last World Cup cost England dearly in terms of seeding this time round. In any case, all teams will have to leave their headquarters and play in other parts of France. The England coach had this reaction to the decision over seeding.
A shade disappointed, because obviously if we're seeded, then it makes the pathway a little bit easier, if you like. But come what may, if you're going to go there and attempt to win a World Cup, you're going to have to play the very best at some stage.
We won't know until Thursday evening exactly who England and Scotland will be playing next summer. There is just a possibility they may be drawn together in one of the eight qualifying groups. But two teams will go through from each group to the knockout stages of the 98 World Cup. Along with the organisers, football fans around the world are counting the days. It all kicks off on June the 10th, with the final in Paris on July the 12th. Neil Bennett, BBC News, in Marseille.
Dentists have warned that up to 5 million people may find they are unable to get dental treatment on the NHS unless they re-register before the new year. The new rules will only affect those patients who haven't seen their dentist in the last 15 months.
Your 6 month checkup. Let's have a look around.
30 million patients are currently registered with NHS dentists, but in future that could fall. Although under the old rules, anyone who'd not been to their dentist in 2 years would be deregistered, ministers have implemented changes made by the Conservatives, reducing that period to 15 months.
Being deregistered as a National Health patient means that you won't get immediate pain relief from your National Health dentist, and you may have to wait several days to get an appointment with your National Health dentist. Alternatively, you have to pay privately with a private dentist to actually get pain relief.
Dentists get £5 per adult per year, even if they don't treat them. The government believes if people haven't seen their dentist in 15 months, they're unlikely to in the future. The changes could save £20 million, but dentist leaders question Labour's commitment to NHS dentistry.
We're not sure what New Labour's agenda is for NHS dentistry. We do have very serious concerns about their attitude to NHS dentistry, but we've yet really to hear what they have to say.
Now, the government is committed to ensuring that patients get access to NHS dentistry in all parts of the country. Now, of course, we recognise that there are a few places where it is difficult to get access, and that's why we've made £9 million available during the course of this year, precisely to plug those gaps.
In the past 2 years, 800,000 people have dropped off dentist lists. Many have gone private. Some fear this move will increase that number. Richard Hannaford, BBC News.
The time, 16 minutes past six. Still to come, the Spencers agree to end their courtroom feud with a £2 million settlement.
The first heavy snowfalls bring disruption to much of Britain.
And one of wrestling's major stars, Big Daddy, has died.
After a week of acrimonious exchanges in a South African court, the eight-year marriage of Earl and Countess Spencer will formally end tomorrow in Cape Town. The case came to a sudden halt after the couple's lawyers agreed a financial settlement that will see the Countess receive about £2 million.
Negotiations had got markedly simpler around Cape Town's High Court this morning. With the Spencer case over, the only thing left to talk about was a hole in the ground. Last night it was very different. Lawyers for both sides emerged after hours spent in discussion. The smiles told the changed story. Most of it anyway.
Can you say anything about the financial settlement?
Whatever there is in the statement.
It's all here. Everything's here.
It wasn't. The precise terms, thought to involve a one-off payment to Victoria Spencer of around £2.5 million, are not being publicised. What is a new mood of harmony between the couple, who are now withdrawing all allegations against each other. Their divorce could now take place as early as tomorrow, which means the media attention Charles Spencer in particular has had to cope with will finally start to let up. An aide of his was clearly relieved.
Earl Spencer's delighted that the events of the last week have been brought to a conclusion and that for the sake of the children they can both move on to their future lives and that all the allegations against him have been withdrawn.
This has clearly been an exceptionally painful case both for Charles and Victoria Spencer. In the end, it's difficult to resist the conclusion that the intense media coverage forced them both to settle early and that Charles Spencer, in the face of multiple attacks on his reputation, had most reasons to compromise. Jeremy Vine, BBC News, Cape Town.
Two firefighters have died in Australia, where bushfires have been raging out of control. Thousands of firefighters, many of them volunteers, were drafted in to tackle the blazes in New South Wales. Hundreds of homes and schools have had to be evacuated in the suburbs of Sydney.
Sydney is fast becoming encircled by flames. The worst of the fires are to the south of the city, the afternoon sky turning black with smoke and ash. 100 degree temperatures and high winds fanned the fires, pushing them closer to homes than anyone had expected. Thousands were evacuated as the flames closed in. In the heat and panic of the moment, some families became separated.
The metal explodes down there! There at the back of the house here!
The last time Sydney burnt was 3 years ago. It's not as serious yet, but the authorities fear it could easily get worse. Army firefighters have been drafted in, but several homes have already been destroyed.
We'll try, we can only try, but she's coming up pretty quick and we've not got enough trucks, but you can see how many houses are leaving now.
Around the state of New South Wales, 400 separate bushfires are now burning. The emergency services admit more than half are out of control. Near the city of Lithgow, two firemen were killed when a sudden rush of wind blew the flames up through the valley, leaving them with no escape. Helicopters and fixed-wing aircraft have been flying non-stop, dousing the flames with water laced with special fire-retarding chemicals. Michael Peshart, BBC News, Sydney.
Two people died on the roads today as the first heavy snows of winter hit much of Britain. The worst hit areas are southern England and Wales. More snow is forecast for tonight.
After one of the mildest autumns in recent times, winter has finally struck. Snowdonia and other parts of North Wales were subjected to snow showers and sub-zero temperatures, making driving difficult on some roads. The southeast of England was one of the areas worst affected. The weather brought with it the inevitable problems on minor and major roads. The scenery in the region was transformed by snowfalls overnight in places like Hertfordshire, Kent, Surrey and Essex. Even though the Met Office say this weather isn't unusual for this time of year, it's prompted the predictable speculation about whether we'll have a white Christmas. One bookmaker has reduced the odds from 7-1 to 4-1 after receiving thousands of pounds worth of bets. A taste of the real thing for these children at a normally dry ski slope in Kent. Such conditions may continue. Forecasters say there'll be more sleet and snow showers this evening in Scotland, East Anglia and the South East. Peter Hunt, BBC News.
Elderly people will, from next year, get a 3.6% rise in the basic retirement pension. The government says that the pension for married couples will rise by £3.60 to more than £100 a week. There will also be a rise in income support for people over 80 years old.
Controversial plans to allow peat to be removed from protected parts of the Yorkshire Moors have been abandoned. The government's conservation watchdog, English Nature, said it would maintain protected status for the peatland of Thorn and Hatfield Moors, which environmentalists argue is home to many endangered plant and animal species.
It's a peat moorland wilderness with an international reputation for unique flora and fauna. 5,000 years of preserved natural history boasts very rare fungi and endangered mosses. Environmentalists argued that any change to the status of the acres of lowland bog would threaten wetland wildlife. Now, English Nature, who manage the reserve, can continue their restoration work across the moors.
50% is coming back to us very rapidly. We get hundreds of acres every year as it comes out of milling. We've flooded that land. It's now got the peat-forming species coming back on it, and thanks to our restoration work is actually recolonising as peatland.
Conservationists, welcoming English Nature's decision, now want a joint campaign to change government policy.
We've lost over 94% of peatlands within this country. It's a habitat that's on the brink of destruction within this country. We must save these sites, and now.
Managing this precious reserve to please every environmental interest is an almost impossible task, while the commercial neighbour has a legal right to exploit the raw material on site. Commercial peat extraction earns millions of pounds at garden centres, mostly abroad after protests here, where it's sold as soil conditioner. Only government legislation could stop the business and preserve the ancient boglands described by the Prince of Wales as precious living landscapes. John Thorne, BBC News, Thorn Moors.
The former wrestler Big Daddy has died 2 months after suffering a stroke. He was 60. Big Daddy became a television star in the 70s with millions of fans tuning in to watch him fight fellow wrestlers like Mick McManus and Giant Haystacks. Duncan Kennedy reports.
From glittering capes and printed leotards to Boston crabs and full Nelsons, Big Daddy never gave half measure to wrestling's followers. For three decades, fans roared their approval of the man who threw his weight but never his temper around. He was the sport's 26-stone Mr. Nice Guy. Despite allegations of match-fixing, supporters, if not opponents, had a habit of coming back. Mrs. Thatcher and the Queen were said to be fans.
Well, I've been in wrestling practically all of my life. My father, he was a professional wrestler. And I can recall being a four-year-old and my brothers, and we used to wrestle on the mat at home, so I've been in wrestling all my life.
But in 1987, disaster struck during a bout in Great Yarmouth. Big Daddy's opponent, Mal King Kong Kirk, collapsed and died. It was from natural causes, but the publicity damaged wrestling. A year later, it was dropped from the television schedules. Big Daddy was christened Shirley Crabtree. His father reckoned with a name like that, a little boy would have to know how to survive. He did, and went on to become one of the world's biggest attractions in a trade with more than its fair share of ups and downs.
A motor neurone disease victim who went to the High Court in a bid to allow her GP to give her pain-relieving drugs, even though they could shorten her life, has died. Annie Linsall, who was 47, dropped her two-year court battle in October when her doctor said he was willing to carry out the treatment.
Politicians are debating global warming at the Kyoto conference in Japan. One of the most controversial issues under discussion is what to do with the oil-burning car. Our industry correspondent Stephen Evans has been to California, where fast pollution-free electric vehicles are available. Sales, however, are low.
Los Angeles is the world's car capital, with more automobiles than people. One of the world's mega cities, they live and breathe motor vehicles, with more official bad smog days than any other American city. Exactly a year ago, General Motors put the world's first purpose-built electric car on the California market. It's an engineering triumph with fast, silent acceleration.
Well, it certainly isn't a fringe fad thing. It's a very important strategic initiative towards cleaner and more efficient transportation.
Californians have been slow to take the cars, which now sit on garage forecourts, only a few hundred driven. It's a slow process. A network of recharging stations is yet to be built.
We need electric cars. Right now, they're the only kind of cars that are available on the market that are just about pollution free. But the problem is, we need for them to have a longer range, and we need the price to come down.
California is an oil producer, oil wells inside orange groves. And oil also lobbies against non-oil cleaner cars.
The thing about California, as nowhere else, is that it's a matter of balancing different forces within the market. There are the car companies wanting to produce petrol engines and green cars, and the oil companies, and above all, an extreme mistrust of government.
Wayne King is a concerned citizen against any public funds to promote alternatives to petrol. Every fortnight, his group reviews progress in what's been a successful campaign against promoting electric cars.
I don't think it's up to the government to do the behavior modification to get that done. Now, if people choose to get out of the cars as a free will, that's fine. They should do that. But to have the government subsidize every little piece of something that comes along that might work is going to drain us dry.
The state's Air Resources Board polices fumes. It's ruled that 10% of cars sold must be electric. But will people buy without state help? California has got cleaner with better petrol engines. The hard bit is getting further cuts in fumes. Californians and their cars will not be parted. Stephen Evans, BBC News, Los Angeles.
Well, you either love them or you endure them. Those cinema ads that urge you to dash round to your local curry house or Chinese takeaway, just three steps away from the cinema. The company that makes the ads has decided they've passed their sell-by date and is consigning them to the dustbin. Nick Hyam reflects on this piece of cinematic history.
Take 30 seconds of standard footage and stick a local business's name on the end, and presto, you've an advertisement. Though no local restaurant was ever quite as exotic as this. Such traditional local ads were once an essential part of a trip to the pictures, but in the era of the modern multiplex cinema, they're being replaced by slides because they're cheaper.
The cost of producing ads is what is really the problem. Therefore, finding a more cost-efficient production mechanism for producing local advertising is our way of developing an insurance policy for small business.
Local businesses might have been glad once of an opportunity like this, not anymore, according to the man who runs the restaurant featured in this ad.
It's been totally non-effective, even by offering a 50% reduction on customers' bills. No customers walk through that door.
The local commercials may have been ineffective, but their amateurism was part of their charm.
I used to like them because they really were not slick. They were not very professional. They were just the sort of thing which reminded you more of the old days than now, and perhaps one will be rather nostalgic to see them go.
I'm sick to death of this place. What I could do with is one of those nice posh kitchens like what you see on the telly.
The ads belong to a time when, in the cinema, dreams really did come true. Nick Higham, BBC News.
And there was no need to break the piggy bank.
The main news again. A new tax-free savings scheme, which can be sold in supermarkets, has been unveiled by the government. It's meant to attract low-income savers, but will mean more tax for the better off. The next news is, of course, the 9 o'clock news.
From the 6 o'clock team, good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening to you. Well, it's rather a wintry scene now for the rest of this week for most of us, though the far north may become somewhat milder come Friday afternoon. Now, there is a warning in force for the rest of the night. Certainly where roads are untreated tonight, almost anywhere in Britain, there could be some pretty slippery patches with a fairly widespread frost. And for northern and eastern Scotland, and down through eastern counties of England, further sleet and snow showers adding to the misery. Now, we've seen plenty of showers today, especially across the northeast of Britain there. Also, that rain and sleet continuing through East Anglia and southeast England. Quite a substantial snowfall, as we've seen already on the pictures, across parts of the southeast, over in Wales too, and down through the southwest of England. We've seen some heavy snowfall during the course of the afternoon. Well, those snow showers will continue in the north and the east throughout the night. Further west, though, patches of freezing fog could also develop, and a very, very cold night indeed. Temperatures down to -3 to -6 degrees once again in some areas. Just one or two coasts will see temperatures staying above freezing. More generally, down the eastern side of England, despite that rain and sleet and some snow showers for the downs and the moors, you will see temperatures just hovering a degree or so above freezing tonight. But basically for tomorrow, we are under the influence of the low pressure there on the continent and cyclonic northerly winds on its western flank. So again, for eastern Scotland, especially down through these eastern counties of England, always a good deal of cloud and further rain and sleet to come, with some snow, especially on the higher ground. Freezing fog patches further west still gradually clear away to give most places a good deal of sunshine. It may well be, as the computer picks out here, that we see those showers pepping up again during the day on the eastern side, drawing in rather more cloud and sleet and rain from the North Sea as time goes by. In more detail then, for northern England on Wednesday morning, plenty of cold weather about, some icy roads to watch out for. Again, those sleet and snow showers over and to the east of the Pennines and gathering during the afternoon, leaving western parts seeing the best of the sunshine, temperatures typically 5 degrees. And that's the way things are going to be for many western parts of Britain, just the odd shower on windward coasts and temperatures maybe up to 6 or 7 on the west coast of Wales and southwest England. Looking on then, the high pressure begins to build, but I think for a time on Thursday, still some sleet and snow showers for eastern Britain, more particularly in the southeast, with other parts seeing freezing fog and a cold night, followed by plenty of sunshine by day. Most places on Friday could be dry, at least for most of the time. That's it from me.
Tonight, a Crimewatch special, unsolved cases from the past. The murder of the Dixons, robbed and shot in the back 8 years ago as they walked along a cliff-top path on summer holiday. And a series of armed robberies where a sadist shoots people who've surrendered. Can Crimewatch viewers on old cases once again find new clues? Crimewatch still unsolved. BBC One tonight at 10.
Take your pick. Sardinia, Barbados, Madrid. They're yours on holiday, BBC One, in half an hour. The day's news in the southeast now on BBC One with Mike Embley and Gwennon Edwards.
Tonight, watch out, Mr. Prescott's about. The Deputy Prime Minister's warning to some of London's richest councils.
Also tonight, peace at last for Annie Linsell, who took her battle for a